Make sure you guys hit the subscribe button if you guys are enjoying the content that we're throwing up. And make sure you guys hit the like button if you enjoy the video. And yeah, let's begin. Okay, so picking back up with the last video and Captain Britain, Brian Braddock, being resurrected by Merlin and his daughter Roma. Of course, once he gets back into the main Marvel Universe, which is where he is right now, he ends up kind of traveling back to the Braddock Mansion and going back home and visiting for a time. But almost as soon as he gets there, he's immediately set upon by a handful of enemy forces. And these guys basically identify themselves as being part of a group called the Special Collective. Now, but the Special Collective really kind of comes here and manages to topple Brian Braddock quite readily. I mean, it's not an absolute, you know, crushing experience. He's not, you know, completely and totally obliterated, but he is defeated, you know, pretty handedly. And the reason why here is because once the Special Collective gets their hands on him and they end up taking him to essentially where it is that he's supposed to be, we end up finding out that he's being brought before Saturnine. And the reason for this is that in the aftermath of everything that happened in Earth 238, that the belief of the Omniversal Development Court is that Saturnine had failed, right? She had done something wrong and screwed something up. Now, there's also a couple things going on here, right? And we won't necessarily cover it in, or it's not really covered in this particular comic, but we can go ahead and cover it now. This is the early indication of the Captain Britain Corps. Basically, the idea that Brian Braddock is not the only Captain Britain that exists out there, that every single universe has its own version of Brian Braddock, and that each one of these versions are designed for the purpose of trying to protect that particular universe. Now, the other thing to understand is that Captain Britain's not really designed to be this kind of all-encompassing, nigh-indestructible character capable of protecting his universe. Instead, he's just kind of a person who can kind of bring the core together if there's a threat significant enough or something along those lines. Now, for the most part, the Captain Britain Corps on the whole is not really invoked in this story because it's still relatively new. And again, the main focus was focusing on Captain Britain himself as opposed to, you know, anything else that could have been involved in this particular story. But for Saturnine, because of the fact that she's being held here under the belief that she has failed, when Brian encounters her, she initially believes that he like enjoys this, right? Seeing her basically being subdued, being held as a prisoner because of the fact that she'd failed in such a way, especially because she abandoned him and everybody else on Earth 238 and kind of just did it to seemingly save her own hide. But at the end of the day, he says, no, that's not really my intention here. Now, for what we're seeing in X of Swords right now, which is Saturnine being, for the most part, in love or at least pursuing Brian Braddock, it all really kind of starts here. Once the trial begins to take place, we end up finding out that the person who's presiding over this, the judge of this whole trial, is a guy by the name of Mandragon. And the reason why this is a big deal is because Mandragon, while being the judge, is also the person who's going to take over the role for Saturnine, and he covets power. And so in essence, basically the guy who's going to take her place is the guy presiding over her trial. You see the conflict of interest there, right? One of the first things they do here when this all kicks off is the Omniversal Development Court, led by Mandragon, kind of looks around and says, okay, given everything that's happened in Earth 238, my scientific advisors have informed me that this Jaspers warp is still going on. If we let this go unchecked, if we do not find a way to control this, it's going to spread from that universe into the entirety of the multiverse, and that this guy will basically twist and distort the whole multiverse, right? Meaning it'll have to be wiped clean and started again. The only way for us to contain this is to destroy his universe. Seemingly with the press of a button, right? The turn of a key, they wipe out the entirety of the Earth 238 universe. Now, the funny thing about the Omniversal Development Court is that this is a concept that you're not really going to see very often anymore in Marvel Comics. And that's because by the time you got into the late 1980s, going into the early 1990s, and the idea of just so many cosmic based stories, especially when you have Infinity Gauntlet and the idea of the Living Tribunal playing such a prominent role in that story and achieving a huge amount of popularity, the Living Tribunal would start to become the go-to source for dealing with multiversal problems. And that's why the Omniversal Development Court kind of took a back seat. But while that's happening, the Fury is still in Earth 238. And so even when that entire universe is destroyed, the Fury survives. And the reason why is because the Fury's power set is such that it adapts to the powers of anybody it faces against, right? Its number one protocol is survival. It'll do whatever it needs to do in order to survive. And so when this whole universe is destroyed, the Fury basically finds a way to survive the destruction of this universe and then just exists in this giant empty void and is constantly haunted by the one desire to track down Captain Britain and to kill him. It never gives up. That's kind of what we're constantly told here. And so what ends up happening is we kind of jump back for a second to the early days of Earth 238 of that universe when everything popped off, right? You know, when Jim Jaspers first started seizing power and when he created the Fury. And we pick up with Captain UK, a woman by the name of Linda. But we pick up with her and her husband Rick in that universe when it was basically them just kind of taking refuge from the Fury, right? At this point, the Fury's killed pretty much everybody, right? Like, it's killed everybody across the world, and they're really like the only ones left. And so when the Fury breaks in here, immediately Awesome Andy starts going after it. And Andy Android, to give you guys perspective, in the main Marvel universe, Andy Android was powerful enough to lift Thor's hammer, right? That's why he's called Awesome Andy. He's a really, really powerful construct. To be destroyed by it like this, by the Fury, really says something, right? From there, the Fury goes into Miracle Man, tears him up as well, right? Kills him. All these guys just start falling and dying everywhere. And it ultimately comes down to Captain UK, Linda, and it comes down to her husband, Rick, and there's nothing they can do. And so what Rick ends up doing is actually putting her into a universal teleporter that'll teleport her to an alternate reality. He sticks her in there. She basically tells him to look out. He's killed right as the device is activated. She teleports away and she watches her husband die. And so that's really kind of where her PTSD and her anxiety came from, as she was there watching as the Fury was killing every single superhero on Earth, and there was nothing she could do to stop it. And so once you get back to the main trial itself, you have Brian Riddick, who's there basically as a defense for Saturnine. And as soon as this world is destroyed, he kind of starts to get pissed off and starts to freak out, right? And that alone is kind of a strike against him by the court, right? They're just kind of looking for reasons to discredit this guy. And so once Saturnine's able to issue her defense, she basically says that, like, the push went exactly the way that it was supposed to. And it happened exactly the way that it was supposed to, right? Everything was fine. We don't know, like, the only thing that we can surmise here is that some kind of reality storm took place, right? Somebody somewhere out there did something that basically twisted that reality up, right? It was not us. We didn't screw anything up. We did the push the same way we've done it countless times before. Brian Braddock was an unexpected involvement in this, but by no means were his actions the ones responsible for this, right? There was this Fury thing that was out there and it was trying to kill everybody. We got out while we could and we figured we'd fix the problem later. And so once that defense is offered, the expectation is that Brian is going to be the one to testify, but immediately he's shot down by Mandragon. And the idea of Mandragon is he basically says, this case you're presenting is nonsense. I don't believe it. I don't really believe anything you're telling me right now. Not only that, you brought this guy, Captain Britain, here to testify, but I believe the two of you are lovers. And I believe that he's been instructed to lie in court to secure your acquittal. So I'm not even going to let him testify in the first place, right? It's obviously a kangaroo court, right? It's a farce. And so when Brian Braddock gets pissed, that's it, right? They basically end up restraining him and they call it a day. And so Saturnine is essentially sentenced to execution, right? She's sentenced to be executed, really, that everything that happened in Earth 238, and it's supposed to be the end of her. What ends up happening instead is that Brian Braddock basically breaks free of his confines. He grabs Saturnine along with a handful of others, and they basically take off, right? The Special Collective, Saturnine, Brian Braddock, they bail. Now, for the most part, Mandragon's not really pissed off about this, because in his mind, it's kind of like, okay, that's basically fine, because all it does is just really go more towards her guilt, so I can use that against her when she's captured and the trial recommences. But for the character of Linda, right, Captain UK in the main Marvel Universe, the reason why this is also important here is because she ends up grabbing the morning newspaper, and her worst dreams begin to come to fruition when you find out that Mad Jim Jaspers in the main Marvel Universe is doing exactly what Jim Jaspers in the alternate universe did, in Earth 238 did. He starts calling for superhero legislation to outlaw superheroes, right? So everything that's happened before is happening again, right? To quote Battlestar Galactica, right? And so with the Special Collective and with Brian Braddock and those guys basically toppling the forces who were there, they end up making their escape, and they're officially end up traveling back to the Braddock Mansion. Now, while all that happens and while that's going on, once they get there, you end up having Captain UK, Linda, who shows up here. Now, normally the Captain Britain characters, right? These different versions of Captain Britain from across the multiverse are supposed to be exceedingly brave characters. This girl is terrified because she looks at what's going on and she's like, history's repeating itself. Switch to a TV kind of broadcast by Jim Jaspers himself, basically the Prime Minister of London now. And he basically, you know, using his powers to achieve that goal, he basically says, I'm calling on legislation to be passed to ban the superheroes who are out there, right? To ban all superheroes in London, right? To get rid of all that stuff. If they can be trusted, why are they wearing masks, right? There are people out there with a huge amount of power that have the ability to literally wipe out entire countries, right? We have to get rid of these guys. It's basically fear-mongering. And so following that, you end up having Brian, who speaks directly with Linda, you know, and she's like, it's the exact same speech he made in my universe. The exact same lines, right? The exact same statements, all of it, right? It's all basically the same thing. Everything that happened before is going to happen again in this universe, and there's nothing we can do to stop it. Now, from there, you switch over to the very little involvement that you get with the rest of the Marvel Universe when you have Jim Jaspers meeting with Henry Peter Gyrick and Sebastian Shaw. talk. And the reason why this matters is because this takes place during Chris Claremont's run on the X-Men. And so because of that, because Jim Jaspers is a mutant, it made sense to kind of cross those two things over. Remember, in America, at the time that all this is happening with Jim Jaspers, in America, you have Operation Wide Awake, right? So you have Project Wide Awake being launched by the federal government for the purpose of containing and controlling the mutant threat. In essence, Jim Jaspers seems to share the same ideologies as Henry Peter Gyrick and Sebastian Shaw. What they don't know is that his intention is not to truly safeguard Britain. His intention is to conquer the world. These guys are completely and totally oblivious to the fact that they are standing in the presence of what is, in effect, the most powerful mutant in the universe. But we start to see the small little ways in which Jim Jaspers is able to use his powers in a far more nuanced measure in comparison to his counterpart from Earth 238, when he has a glass of white wine, which he despises, and he changes it into red wine, right? It's small, it's subtle, but it's a huge differentiation because it means that his ability to control his powers are far more nuanced than the version from Earth 238. He was relatively new, and that's when you have Roma and Merlin kind of watching all this unfold, and they say, okay, the game now begins, right? The test of Jim Jaspers is, can he pull this off? And so what he ends up doing is actually calling a woman by the name of Vixen. Now, Vixen is a character who was a foe of Captain Britain for quite some time, but one of the things that kind of goes on here in the Captain Britain stories is you had the formation of a group called Strike, the Special Tactical Reserve for International Key Emergencies. And Strike was basically a organization that operated inside Britain that served the purpose of quelling threats that went beyond any particular intelligence agency's ability to handle. MI5, MI6, whatever those intelligence agencies are in Britain, I'm not really well versed with those. They're not really equipped to handle people with superpowers, but Strike is. But in order to ensure that Strike functioned according to what it was that Jim Jaspers wanted, he actually orchestrated a situation where Vixen was able to infiltrate Strike. She's basically a crime lord. And so she basically runs the show. And so because she's the one running Strike, Strike is now effectively the personal army of Jim Jaspers. And he tells her that, like, within a week, Strike will receive direct orders from the British government to eradicate all the superheroes. And that's exactly what happens, right? That seemingly within a few days or so, that every single superhero that we can find is captured, right? Every single superhero in that in London itself is captured, and they're thrown into internment camps. And this is all happening the way that it happened in the Earth 238 universe, right? That internment camps were created for individual superpowers, and over time, they were destroyed, right? They were completely and totally eradicated. And so what you end up getting here is that where Linda kind of panics and can't really handle it, she basically storms off and leaves. She's confronted by the Fury, who basically managed to find a way to teleport from his universe, from what was the 238 universe, into the main Marvel universe, right? The name of the game of that guy's powers is adaptation. If he has a target that he's going after, and he's aware that target still exists, he can track them anywhere in the universe. That's the power that Jim Jaspers bestowed upon it and is in the alternate reality, right? That alternate universe version of Jim Jaspers gave the Fury the power to track down any target, no matter where they may be. And it was probably one of these things where Jim Jaspers did it open-ended, never really believing that he would be destroyed and that the Fury's directive would allow it to actually transition from one universe to the next. And that's one of the things that makes the Fury so incredibly powerful. This is a guy that can jump from one universe to another, tracking a target, and is designed to adapt to anybody's power. Now, where the Fury goes against and attacks Linda, Captain UK from Earth 238. Brian Braddock happens to show up just in the nick of time, and ultimately this leads to Brian Braddock facing off against the Fury again. And that's when he's like, the Fury is here, right? Like, this thing is back here. It killed me before. It eradicated all the superheroes on its world. There's no real possible way for us to defeat this thing, right? This thing is wildly powerful. And so what you end up getting is the Special Collective responding at the direction of Saturnine, going after the Fury to save Brian Braddock and to save Linda. But the Special Collective has never experienced the Fury before. They've never come across this guy before. And so their leader just kind of runs headlong into it, like, come on, guys, we got this. And their leader gets totally crushed, right? From there, the Special Collective attacks and they get totally crushed, right? So, like, they went into this under the direction of their leader, believing that their leader knew what was best for them, and totally failed, right? They all almost died. And so in response to that, Special Collective is like, we're not doing this. This is too much, right? Like, what? This is way beyond what you're paying us to do, right? Because they are basically bounty hunters, right? They're mercenaries, not really bounty hunters, but they're mercenaries. And they're like, we're not doing this, right? This is not happening. And so it basically leads to the Special Collective bailing out. But the Fury going through and attacking all these guys brings back all this PTSD in the mind of Linda of all the experiences she had, right? Watching all these superheroes try and fail to defeat this force that's nigh unstoppable. Now, the Fury is kind of weakened by the Special Collective, but only enough for it to basically be halted, right? Only enough for it to kind of be stopped for a minute and by the Special Collective time to basically get out, right? To basically make their escape there. And so once they end up leaving, it's really just kind of left to Brian, Saturnine, Betsy Braddock, And that's really it, right? It's really only left to them to just kind of do the best they can to stave off this measure of power. And so following the application of all these internment camps, right? All these concentration camps where they're rounding up various superpowered beings, they're throwing them in these camps and they're leaving them there with the expectation or the intention of executing them at a future point in time. The Fury is still on the hunt for Captain Britain. But at the same time, Vixen, as the head of Strike, begins to come to this realization that Jim Jaspers is dangerous and that he needs to be stopped, right? There's something else going on here besides the fact that he's just the prime minister and that he's ordering the execution of all these superheroes, that something bad is going on besides that. Now, you'd think that would be bad enough, but there's something else nefarious happening. And so she travels to 10 Downing Street, I think is what it's called, which is the location of where the prime minister resides. Basically, kind of like Britain's version of the White House, if there was such a thing. British members of the Rob Corps, you guys can correct me on that. But as soon as she gets in there, everything is topsy-turvy. And that's when she realizes she screwed up. She screwed up in the worst way, that he starts using his powers and stretching out and screwing up her henchmen, turning them into like these just kind of monstrous and grotesque things. And then he in turn uses his powers and transforms her into an actual vixen, right? Into a female fox. And so again, the power of Jim Jaspers being able to rematerialize things, transform a person into something else. That's the kind of power that we're talking about here. And so from there, you basically pick up with Brian coming to this realization that with Jim Jaspers existing in his universe, that he has to confront him, right? That he has to confront Jim Jaspers head on. And so once he ends up, what he ends up doing is traveling again to Downing Street itself. And as soon as he walks in there, everything's on fire. Everything's kind of twisting, turning, right? It's all completely and totally screwed up. The laws of physics have completely and totally gone awry here. And so once he opens the door, he's kind of met by this statement, right? This statement where he's basically told, you know, can I help you, sir? You appear to be lost, lost in the funhouse. And it's just this enormous besiege of Jim Jaspers that's just huge in scale, right? There's seemingly, like, he literally walked into his office and it turned into a universe. That's the power of Jim Jaspers, to skew and to break the laws of physics. Now, from there, you end up picking up with Saturnine confronting Linda. And where Linda's kind of terrified by everything going on, she was like, you have to go help him, right? Like, he can't do this on his own. You have to go help him. Like, you're our only real chance here. And she's kind of gripped by fear, right? Paralyzed by fear, anxiety, the PTSD she's experienced, the terrible situations. And so Saturnine starts goading her, right? She's like, you're a coward then. You let your world die. You let your lover die. You let everybody that you care about die because you're a coward. You're no measure of a Captain Britain at all, right? Like, we failed. Merlin and Roma, they failed in bringing you on, right? You are not any kind of real measure of a superhero. I know that because you're sitting here sniveling like a little child, afraid of the big bad guy. And that's when Linda starts to freak out, finally regains her courage in the face of her anger, and then says, okay, fine. So like, she ends up donning her Captain UK uniform, intending to go directly after Captain Britain and to help save him from Jim Jaspers, right? To help them defeat Jim Jaspers. And the funny thing about this is that you end up having this thing where you have Captain Britain. This is kind of nuts here, right? This is let me tell you something. It's crazy. He confronts Jim Jaspers and he says, like, if you're even remotely sane, you can't do this, right? Jim Jaspers is like, I'm not sane and I can do this. And he's like, fine, then I'll fight you with every breath in my body. And then he suddenly wakes up. He's there with Jackdaw. He's there with Saturnine. And he's like, Jackdaw, I thought you were dead. He was like, no, man, like, we're facing off against some enemies here, but like, you've just been babbling like a madman, right? You've just been babbling like a madman, going on about nothing. Is everything okay? And so you're kind of given this indication that what we've been experiencing here in this universe is actually a dream, right? In the main Marvel universe, is actually a dream. And instead, they're just kind of facing off against this crazy threat. But as he's talking to Jackdaw and as he's talking to Saturnine, he kind of reaches over, he pulls down what looks like this giant sheet, this fabric, and like, literally the whole scene comes tearing down, right? Like a piece of paper. And then suddenly he's in a hospital and it's like, nurse, he's awake, right? Like, he can't possibly have, right? I mean, like, this is crazy that he's basically talking to his mother, right? And it's kind of like, you know, like, this is sort of nuts, right? This is kind of crazy. Like, you know, he has amnesia, you know, and that he's finally awake, you know, and that he was in a car accident up in Darkmoor, so he never became Captain Britain. This reality starts shifting. And that's when you have him pop back up to Jim Jaspers and he's like, you said you were telling me something about fighting me with every breath in your body. Like, you're hopelessly outclassed. That's the power of Jaspers, right? Like, imagine a story, like, imagine the events of House of M. That's what Jaspers is doing here to Captain Britain. That's the level of power we're talking about here, guys. A guy who could basically rewrite all of reality around a singular person and then trick them into believing that things are the way they are, screwing with his head. Of course, you end up having Brian, who, once he realizes what's going on, he's like, you don't belong here, right? This power you have, you know, you're using it for evil means. Like, I'm gonna kill you. I'm gonna destroy you. That's when Jaspers starts messing with him again, right? Snapping his fingers, he's in hell. Snap his fingers again, he's in a classroom. Snap his fingers again after that, like, he's inside of a wheat eater, right? Like, he's just inside of like a a bush hog, snapping his fingers again and again and again and again. And everything around Brian Braddock is just twisting and changing and skewing, right? It's nuts. And all this means is that Brian Braddock is painfully out of his league. He has no answer for Jim Jaspers. And the funny thing about this is that the way in which Jim Jaspers is defeated doesn't even come from Brian Braddock himself. Instead, seemingly out of nowhere, with him finally tracking down Brian Braddock, the Fury goes on the attack. And he immediately starts going after Brian Braddock, right? Starts pummeling him. He ends up breaking his arm, right? Just beating the absolute hell out of this guy. And so what ends up happening here is that Jim Jaspers basically creates the crazy gang out of nowhere, right? Just kind of creates him out of dirt. And it's like, I created everything in existence and I need you guys to defeat Brian Braddock. But then like, as soon as the Fury shows up, he's like, I never created that. Like, that's weird. And so he starts looking at the Fury, starts kind of examining him, right? It's just kind of like, you're a little strange. Like, I mean, I feel like I've met you before, but this is a little weird. But the Fury is looking at Jim Jaspers and the Fury's like, okay, I was programmed to not kill Jim Jaspers, but that program came from an alternate reality. That was the alternate reality version of Jim Jaspers. This is not that guy. So my programming should allow me to kill him. And so basically the Fury goes after Jim Jaspers. And what you get here is the Fury's ability to adapt versus Jim Jaspers' ability to control reality. An unstoppable force meets an immovable object is what this is. And so every time Jim Jaspers launches an attack, the Fury adapts, right? It's attack, adapt, attack, adapt, attack, adapt. It's over and over and over again, right? Just constantly. And the more that Jim Jaspers attacks, the more the Fury adapts. So the powers start to become more and more extreme to the point where they rewrite reality and they're fighting on the moon. Then they change reality and they're fighting on the sun. They change reality, they're fighting in hell. Reality is shifting in such a way that with Merlin watching all this unfold, it actually overwhelms his mind and kills him. Now, the funny thing about this is that Merlin actually fakes his death. He's not actually dead. That was a way for them to kind of make him appear dead and then have him create Excalibur in Marvel Comics. That's really kind of where that comes from. But they keep rewriting reality and changing things, right? And everything keeps getting screwed up around them, keeps getting skewed to the point that they're actually turning into creatures that don't even really exist. But it's basically these two guys facing off against each other. And the Fury comes to this realization, this fight would be limitless, right? This fight would go on forever and ever. And they would actually end up destroying all of reality and the process, right? Because the powers would just get so extreme. More and more altering of reality would take place. And so the Fury kind of starts calculating. Like, while this fight is going on, the Fury starts calculating and says, there's only actually one way to end this fight. So he switches and he teleports Jim Jaspers to Earth 238, where there is no universe. Because the Fury figured out that Jim Jaspers' powers require him to have a universe to alter. And that right there is the difference between adult Franklin Richards and Jim Jaspers. That Jim Jaspers has to have a universe to create anything in, right? That he's not really creating something out of nothing. He's just altering the existing fabric of the universe. He has to have a reality in order to alter. Franklin Richards, we saw in Jonathan Hickman's Fantastic Four, he can create something out of nothing. Like, he can just create a universe out of nothing. So like, we've seen him do that before. So that's the huge difference between these two guys. But with Jim Jaspers being in a place where there is no universe, then basically he's powerless. He's just an average guy. The Fury puts his hands to his head, fries his brain, and that's the end of Mad Jim Jaspers. Following that, the Fury ends up traveling back to the main Marvel Universe with the intention of going after Captain Britain. The problem with this is that all that effect of reality warping and adapting to the various forms that Jim Jaspers was taking on took a huge toll on the Fury and pushed him to the extreme, so much so that he is exceedingly weakened. And so because of that, it offers Brian Braddock alongside Linda the one chance they need to destroy it. And that's exactly what they do, right? They use their powers and completely annihilate the Fury. Really more Linda. They basically saves Brian Braddock than anything else, but they completely and totally obliterate the Fury. And that ends that, right? The Fury's destroyed. Jim Jaspers is destroyed. But the caveat to this is that Saturnine, realizing the power that she could potentially possess here, actually ends up extracting a DNA sample of Jim Jaspers. Now, this is important. The reason why I really wanted to include this in here, and the reason why it's important is because I would surmise the next time that we see Jim Jaspers basically in Marvel, the next time we see him is in X-Men Die by the Sword, I believe, and it is in the aftermath of House of M, and that you end up seeing him reemerge, but he's merged with the Fury, right? That's not real. That doesn't really seem to be anything that that Hickman is following in his Exos Swords event. And so what this looks like is that Saturnine made good, that she actually ended up cloning Jim Jaspers, and he's the one that runs a crooked market, right? He's a recreation of Saturnine. Now, she may have altered his mind, altered his memories. We don't really know. But regardless of the situation, what this does is it leads to a funeral funeral, kind of a funeral for Merlin, even though he's not actually dead, right? And basically the day's been saved, right? Saturnine just kind of has an ace up her sleeve, which she uses on Mandragon, right? She ends up going to visit Mandragon and she's like, you're gonna give me a full pardon. Otherwise, I'm going to take this clone body of Jim Jaspers that we're creating right now and I'm gonna unleash it on your world and let him just lose his mind and go crazy. So of course, she gets a full pardon. She's returned back to being the position of Magistrix. That's kind of how she's maintained her position ever since. But the day's basically saved. Right? You know, that's kind of how the story ends. But, you know, I wanted to throw this out there and I wanted to bring this to you guys because I thought it was important to understand the power Jaspers has and why him being in X of Swords is potentially a massive credible threat, right? Because this guy has a ridiculous level of power. So with that being said, guys, we're going to bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoy this video, make sure you drop a like and I will catch you all later. Peace.